I would like to welcome you to the lecture number 6 of 2FH3. We'll continue our discussion of vector calculus, and we'll finish today what remains in chapter 3. So we'll be ready to start electrostatics in the following lecture. We'll discuss today a number of things, including the curl operator, Stokes theorem, classification of vectors, Laplacian of a scalar. And we cover in this this lecture, chapter 3, pages 80 to 95. I thought of starting this lecture by giving you a mechanical example that will help you understand the meaning of the curl. So I took this from the book of Iskander, very, very famous book. It was used 20 years ago. I'm not sure whether it's still in print or not, but I like this example a lot because it helps you understand what's meant by curl. So we have here a water tank. These are the two walls. This one wall of the water tank. This is here a second wall of the water tank. And you have water flowing in the Z direction. So the water flows from the bottom of the beach to the top of the beach. And the water does not have the same velocity in the cross section. So if you go in the Y direction, if you move in the Y direction, you will see that this is a profile of the velocity. The water is very fast in the middle, has very strong velocity in the middle in the Z direction. And the velocity is tapering until it reaches zero at the edges of the tank. So the water velocity near the edges of the tank is zero, and it's very fast in the middle. So it has a profile. We use a device called the curlometer. The curlometer, this is how the curlometer looks like. It has two parts. Four feathers normal to each other, as shown here, connected with a tiny rod to a floating ball with a black dot to its side. This is called the curlometer. It's a mechanical curlometer. It measures the curl of mechanical waves. Now, let's take a look at three different situations. The first one is when the curlometer is exactly in the middle of the tank. So here, it's floating with water. The water is moving in the Z direction. This is the direction here. This is the direction of Z. And the curlometer is exactly in the middle. Because of the symmetry, you can see the symmetry of the profile of the velocity. If the ball is exactly in the middle, the velocity to the right will be exactly equal to the velocity to the left. So the forces affecting the curl, the curlometer to the right and to the left are the same, and then the curlometer will not rotate. Or could not rotate. So we say there is no circulation. We say there is no curl in this case. As you can see, it does not. Why there is no curl? Because the curlometer does not see any difference in the velocity to the right and the velocity to the left. The black point does not rotate in this case. Now let's take a look at another case where this curlometer is actually a little bit to the left in the tank, and it's flowing with the tank with the water in the Z direction. Because the velocity of the profile of the velocity to the right of the curlometer here is stronger than the velocity to the left, what will happen is that the water will push this curlometer to start rotating in the counterclockwise direction. So as it moves, it's rotating. You see that the black dot here start to rotate in the counterclockwise direction because the velocity to the right is stronger than the velocity to the left. So here in this case, we applied what we call the right-hand rule. We say, okay, because of the velocity profile, there is a curl, and the curl is normal to the plane of the beach. And here in this case, the curl, if you apply the right-hand rule, if you have a right-hand screw, if it is rotating in the counterclockwise direction, then it's going to be progressing out of the beach. So the curl here is in the positive x direction. This is actually x normal. The normal direction to the beach is a positive x direction. So I can simply try and say and draw it as we agreed. I can simply see there is a dot here, and this is x, and it's coming out from the beach. Now, for the other case, where you put the curlometer in the right side of the tank, you could see the curlometer will start to flow with the water. This is fine. But because the velocity to the left is stronger than the velocity to the right, you see that the curlometer starts to rotate as it's moving in the clockwise direction. And this would create a curl, if you apply the right-hand rule, a curl going into the beach. So we see here we have a negative curl. So the curl as a quantity, it measures at a certain point in a certain plane, it measures how the field is changing in that plane around that point, whether this field can cause a circulation, and its direction is normal to that plane. So this is really the essence of this for the case of mechanical waves here, as you could see. Another important thing to notice, I decided to go back this slide again, and it's great to use this kilometer here to be able to measure the curl of a mechanical wave. But what if we have a wave that's given by a mathematical expression, not a mechanical wave? Of course, electromagnetic waves, we cannot use a mechanical kilometer for them. And of course, if you have a mathematical expression, you cannot use a mechanical kilometer for that. There must be another way of measuring the curl. Well, the way of measuring the curl that you can do it mathematically is through a line integral. So this is how things will go. Let's pick one point. I will pick this point here, this point in the middle of this contour. And I will call this point here B1. I would like to measure the curl normal to the plane of the page at this point of this function. So what I will do, I will build a closed contour around that point. And here, I'm assuming the same velocity profile we have seen in the previous example. So the velocity is very strong in the middle. The field is very strong in the middle. It is weaker as you go to the sides, as you can see from the intensity of the lines. It becomes sparse as you go to the right and to the left. So here, if you could see what's happening, if you do a line integral around this, element here, E dot dl will give you zero along this segment, because this segment is normal to the direction of the vector. E dot dl will give you zero here as well. E dot dl here will be positive, because the direction of the velocity of the field. E dot dl here will be negative. So, and 1 and 2, because of the symmetry of the profile, will cancel each other out. So here the integral of E dot dl will give you zero, or if even here it's called f. The integral of f dot dl is equal to zero, saying that there is no circulation. There is no circulation because the velocity does not change in that plane. Now, let's take a look at the left side. So again here, we can create another point in the middle. I want to measure the curl at this point, which I will call here P2. So what I will do, I will create a very tiny contour around that point, as you can see here. And then I will try to measure the circulation around that point using that contour. So look what is happening. We have again four integrals of E dot dl. This is a closed contour. This segment here will give you zero because the direction of the vector is normal to that segment. This segment will give you zero again because dl is normal to the vector. Here, F dot dl will give you a positive number. Here, F dot dl will give you a negative number. Because of the direction of the segment here, in the direction of the vector, and here in the direction opposite to the vector. But notice, because of the non-symmetry, you can see that the velocity to the right is stronger than the velocity to the left. So the positive segment here will have a higher value for its integral than this negative segment, which means that we have, in this case, positive circulation. And of course, we are assuming, as shown here, that the x direction is pointing out from the page. This simply means that in this case, there is a positive circulation, there is a positive rotation. So the curl normal to the plane at this point is actually positive. So we take a third point, which is this point here. I will call this point here B3. To measure the curl normal to the plane of the page at that point, what we do, we create a contour, another tiny contour around that point, and we measure all four integrals. And as I did before, this segment and this segment will give you zero. This segment will give you a positive answer. This segment will give you a negative answer. But in this case, the negative segment will have a higher value than the positive segment because of the profile of the velocity. So this means that the curl in this case is going to be negative. So you could see what's a very important thing. If you want to measure the curl in a certain normal to a certain plane at a certain point, then create a contour, a very tiny contour around that point, and measure the circulation. And see the circulation around that point through a line integral. If it is positive, or it's negative, or it is zero. And this will be able to give you the curl of the field at that point. So this is how we really measure the curl in Cartesian coordinates and other coordinates. I will maybe go very fast on how this is being done. So this is the definition of the curl. If you want to measure the curl around the point, build a closed contour around that point and divide by the area of that contour, so the area enclosed by that contour. Remember, every closed contour will enclose an area. And then try to make this contour as small as possible. Make all its dimensions go to zero. And by the way, this is a formula they use to calculate the expression for the curl in the cylindrical, spherical, and Cartesian coordinates using these differential elements we talked about way earlier. So here there is a point. I showed this paragraph. There is a point here, and I will call this point here B1, and I would like to calculate the curl normal to the yz plane, so in the x direction. So I create a tiny contour around that point as shown here. There is a tiny contour. I calculate E dot dl. I divide by the area. The area is going to be delta y delta z, and I take the limit as delta y delta z becomes very small, and of course in the limit the delta becomes a d, and you get all types of derivatives. Now, I want you to understand one very important thing. I'm just showing you here one component, how to calculate one component of the derivative, of the curl. But the curl actually has three components. The second component, you can have it by, again, around that same point. If you draw an element parallel to the yz plane, and did that curl, if you calculate E dot dl here, this element is parallel to the xy plane, is parallel to the xy plane, it will give you the curl along the z direction. And you can draw one more element, so I can simply here draw one more element, which is parallel to the xz plane, something like this, again with center at the point B. This one would have dimensions dx, this one would be dz here, and this one here is dx. This will give me the circulation or the direction of the curl normal in the y direction. So these three elements that we talked about, or these three line integrals, they are all part of the differential element, Cartesian differential element we mentioned in an earlier lecture. And if you carry out these expressions for all these three planes or these three tiny differential early area elements, and you can look up the proof, you'll see that the expression for the curl that you will obtain is this one here. It's really obtained by a determinant, where the first line are the unit vectors in the x, y, and z. And then you get partial x, partial y, partial z, ax, ay, and az. So you differentiate, for example, the x component, differentiate az relative to y minus ay relative to z. The same thing for the y component with a negative sign. You differentiate az relative to x minus az minus ax relative to z, and so on. So by that way, you can calculate the curl. You could repeat exactly the same procedure using the differential elements we talked about before. For example, in cylindrical, we talked about this differential element. We agreed that this is a volume differential element. So what you will do, you will carry out three surface integrals here, And for example, you can calculate, make a circulation here, and make this element goes to zero, and this will give you the curl normal in this direction, which is in the phi direction, and so on. And you do it exactly for spherical, and so on. You get very complicated expressions. I'm not going to be quizzing you on this. I recommend that you read how they obtain these expressions. They can be derived, and the derivation may be a little bit lengthy. But this is how the curl looks like in cylindrical coordinate systems. And as you can see, for the rho component, you differentiate az relative to phi. You differentiate a phi relative to z. For the phi component, differentiate a rho relative to z. Differentiate az relative to rho. For the z component, differentiate a phi relative to rho. Differentiate a relative to phi. So you can see here we have all types of derivatives between the different components here. And when you get the rho component, you don't see any rho inside the bracket. When you talk about the phi component, there is no phi inside the bracket. When you talk about z component, there is no z inside the bracket. For spherical coordinates, it even becomes more complicated. I cannot even put them in one line, so I prefer to put every component separately. So the curl will have three components. This one here is the r component. This one here is the theta component. This one is the phi. And as you could see again, in the r component, there is no derivative of AR. In the theta component, there is no derivative of A theta. In the phi component, there is no derivative of A phi. You use these expressions and you through which you can obtain the curl of your vector. I'm showing you here an example of a vector. This vector here has a mathematical expression, f is equal to minus y ax plus x e y. And if you try to draw the field lines at every point in space, you can see the field is changing its magnitude and direction at every point, causing some total sort indeed of a circulation around the origin. And if you try to obtain the curl expression from the previous slide, you see that the curl is equal to 2az. So indeed the curl is normal to the beige, it has a constant value is equal to 2az. And again we apply the right hand rule, I'm trying to remind you of this. So here the z direction is coming out from the beige, you should be able to drive the expression here for this one. This is another example of a rotational vector. We call this one a rotational vector. It has a curl. Any vector that has a curl is called a rotational vector. So if you try to obtain the curl around that point, so if I come here and try to build a contour, say let's build a contour here around it, okay, and carry out the line integral, you'll see that the field has very strong component along the edges of that line. And as a result, the curl will not be equal to zero. It will have a value. And in this case, it will be coming out from the beige. So this one is a rotational vector. We call this one a rotational vector. While if you take a look at this other field to the other side here, all the field lines are uniform. They are not changing. The field does not change around the point P. So if you try to build an element, or an area element around this point here, and you carry out the integral, the line integral that we had earlier, you will see that these two edges will give you a zero answer. These two edges, maybe I should try to show you the direction. So if I select the direction of circulation to be this way here, direction of the elements, so this edge here and this edge here will give you zero. This one here will give you a positive answer. This one here will give you a negative answer. And these two are the same because the field is uniform. So in that case, we say that the field is irrotational, because if you try to see its curl will be equal to zero as shown here. And the embodying zero vector. Embodying zero vector. Why? Because the curl is a vector. So when it is zero, then all its three components are zeros. So when I say that the field, a vector is a zero, this means that all three components of the vector are zeros. Now, another example here of the curl, I'm showing you here, this example. Remember in this example that the z direction is out from the beige, we assume that. So if you try to build a contour again around that point, and because I'm assuming z is normal to the beige, I will draw this contour to be in the counterclockwise direction. So I draw it this way. So if you calculate f.dl, what will happen? This edge here will give you zero contribution. This edge here will give you zero contribution because they are normal to the field. This one here will give you a positive answer, small though, because the field is getting weaker here. This one will give you a stronger negative answer. Then the total answer here is zero. This function has a curl, but the curl is actually negative here. And we can see why, because of the way the function is changing. So the curl is not actually in the positive z, it's not coming out from the beige. It's going into the beige here. The other figure, you'll see here that for this function here, you'll see that the function is pretty uniform around this point. So again, if we want to see the component of the curl normal to this vector or this plane, what we do, we draw an element, we take e dot dl. Of course, I'm doing it in a vectorial way, but usually you do it mathematically. And you can see that two edges will give you zero, as explained earlier. Two edges will give you the same answer, one positive, one is negative. And as a result, the total curl or the component of the curl normal to the beige is equal to zero. The last one is when you have a field changing that way, you can see the field is becoming stronger as you go in this direction here. So this will create a curl. So if you draw a contour, again, because we're assuming z is normal to the beige, We draw a contour around this point here, and you calculate E dot DL. You'll see that this edge will give you zero, this edge will give you zero, this one will give you a strong positive answer, this one will give you a weak negative answer, because the field is weaker and this in this point. So this means that the curl in general will become a positive number here. Let's take a look at some examples. We have a field A. It's given by y plus 2x, y cosine 2x in the x direction, plus y plus e to the power x in the z direction. So it does not have a y component. Would like to calculate curl A at the origin. Again, this is a very simple substitution. We build the determinant of curl A, ax, ay, az, the derivatives in the second row, and then the components ax, ay, and az. So this vector will have in general three components. In the x direction, you eliminate this row and this row and this column. So what you get, partial y of this term, which will give you 1, minus partial z of 0. And then minus ay here, cancel this column and this row. You get partial x of this term, which will give you e to the power x, minus partial z of this term, which will give you 0. And then the last component is plus az, cancel this column and this row, partial x of 0 minus partial y of this term, which will give you cosine 2x. So here, as you could see, after you put all this together, this is what we'll end up having. These are the three components of the curl. And remember, we obtain these three components not by a single line integral, by three line integrals in three orthogonal planes around that point. And of course, you want to get at any point 0, 0, and 0, both x equal to 0, both y equal to 0, both z equal to 0. You end up with this vector here, curl A is equal to AX minus AY minus AZ. As a second example, in a second coordinate system, I want you to obtain the curl of A in cylindrical coordinates for the vector given by 10 e to the minus 2 rho cosine phi A rho plus 10 sine phi AZ. Would like to evaluate the curl at a specific point. The curl, as we agreed, it's a vector. It changes from one point to another. And if you want to get its value at a specific point, you have to substitute for this point here. Now, when you take a look at an example like this, you should immediately notice a number of things. First, there is no A phi. So any derivative of A phi must give you zero. You must put it to zero, okay? A rho is only a function of rho and phi. It doesn't have z. And the AZ is not a function of rho. AZ is not a function of rho. So this will result in many components giving you zero answer, even though the expression of the curl may be complicated, but many of its components will give you a zero answer. Expand the component of the curl. This is a rho component here, this is a phi component, and this is a z component. Luckily, we don't have A phi, so this term here is zero, this term here is zero. AZ is not a function of rho, so this one here will give you zero. A rho is not a function of z, so this will give you here zero. And you end up only with two components as shown here. Derivative of az relative to phi divided by rho a rho, minus the one coming from this one here, which is minus 1 over rho partial a rho partial phi. So this one here, and this one here. These are the only two that are not zeros. Now you substitute AZ, they had cosine, AZ had cosine sine phi, this gives you cosine phi in the derivative. A rho contained cosine phi, so the derivative will be minus sine phi, will cancel out with this negative sign to get the plus sign. So this is the expression for the curl at any point, and of course you can substitute for any value of rho, phi, and z. And when you do that, this is what you'll end up having. Point of interest, which is rho equal to 2, phi equal to 0 degrees, z is equal to 3. We have the sine will give you sine 0, will give you 0, the cosine will give you 1. You end up only with curl A is equal to 5 rho.